Hey guys, thank you for checking out the video. I just wanted to do a quick breakdown of what I think are the main five big takeaways from the Terrence Howard interview. And it's a few things that I don't think many people are kind of discussing. I see a lot of people online talking about the math and how he's incorrect about the math. I'm not going to get into that. I don't know math. I'm too stupid to understand that stuff. But there's a couple other big points that he mentions that I want to talk about that I don't see a lot of people covering. Some people online I've seen have only seen clips. They haven't even watched the whole video or the whole interview. I've watched it, I think, 3 times now to try to understand more and more. And I have a better understanding of it now. I have a very, very basic understanding of at least the concepts of what he's talking about. I don't know the science. I'm not an expert. So if you want to go listen to an expert talk about it and debunk it, you can go to another channel and check out a bunch of that, I'm sure. But I don't really trust the experts anymore myself. Once you find out that you've been lied to about pretty much everything your whole life, it's hard to believe what the experts will tell you anymore. But I'm sure they have a lot to tell you, a lot of opinions and science to back up what they're talking about. But for here, for what I'm going to talk about is just kind of an overall breakdown in an easy-to-understand way of what Terrence Howard was talking about, because everybody's using all these scientific terms and big words and convoluted, hard-to-understand phrases and complicated explanations. I just want to break it down in a layman's terms way, 5 of the major things that he brought up, and so you can kind of understand it if you're as confused as I was and still am for the most part. He went over a lot of stuff and talked about a lot of stuff, but these are my 5 big takeaways from the Terrence Howard interview, and let's get into it. Okay, I'm going to pull up each thing on the screen as we go. So number 1 that I want to break down is the periodic table, the alternate version of the periodic table that Terrence has brought to the public's attention. Just this alone makes the whole interview worth it to me. The fact that we've never heard of this, I never heard of it, most people probably have never heard of this before. There is an alternate version of the periodic table, and they don't teach you this in school. You never hear about it. And he has brought it up to everybody in a major mainstream way. So I want to break down exactly kind of what this is, just in an easy-to-understand way in layman's terms. So with the current periodic table that we have, it shows every element being separate, independent, isolated on its own. With this alternate version of the periodic table, it shows that every element is one to begin with, one piece of matter. Then it breaks down and unwinds and changes into all the various different elements, depending on the environment that it's in. So it's showing that everything is connected versus everything is isolated. That's the major difference here. It also relates every element to frequency and sound. But that's a little more complicated. I just wanted to give the basic understanding of what it is one piece of matter which twists down and becomes all of the elements, which is a very interesting concept and idea. And it's also crazy because the language that we use, periodic table, what is a table? It's flat. So with this, it's more of a periodic wave. And the wave spirals down, and everything comes out of it. Kind of gives a whole new multi-dimensional meaning to it. That's number 1. I thought it was very interesting that he brought this up when most of us have probably never even heard of it before. So we'll keep going. Number 2 of the breakdown of what he brought up that I thought was very interesting, he was able to bring the work of Walter Russell to the attention of millions of people. I had never heard of this guy before. Science and history has basically written him off, but Tesla and Einstein both looked up to him, and he had completely different ideas of physics and how the universe works. This is one of his books, The Universal One. I'm listening to the audio book version of this right now. I just thought it was cool that he brought this guy up and told everybody about him, because we've never heard of this guy. They don't teach you about him. And I think it was really cool that he brought this guy up, who has a completely different interpretation of the universe, and he exposed this information to all of us. So I thought that was really good. Okay, we're going to keep it going because I want to keep this as quick as I can. Number three, this might be the most important thing of all in this whole interview. The idea of the ether. Okay, so Terrence has brought this back up into the public discussion, and I think this is probably the most important thing. This is what Tesla was all about. In simple terms, easy to understand way, layman's terms, the ether is a connection, a field that connects all living things. All things are connected and part of the ether. This is what Tesla discovered, apparently, allegedly. This is just a kind of a corny cartoon graphic, but I just wanted to pull it up to kind of illustrate it. And I like this explanation here. It says, his experiments revealed the existence of the ether, the ever-present field that connects all things, the non-physical force behind all physical phenomena. So this is what Terrence is talking about. It's not that crazy. I mean, Tesla thought of this, and Walter Russell thought of it. Other people have thought about it before, but Terrence is just kind of bringing it back up to a mainstream audience. And I think the fact that he's getting this into people's minds again is really, really a good thing. Maybe it's not true, but I think it needs to be investigated more, and maybe it is true. If it is true, it could lead to the invention of free technologies, free energy, wireless electricity, all the things that Tesla was allegedly trying to give to the public, or trying to, get out there. So reintroducing the idea of the ether to the public consciousness, I think, is a huge deal. That's number three. Okay, number four, we're going to go to the video clip here, the actual clip of Terrence on the Joe Rogan Experience. For this one, he talks about, he kept saying that he invented tangential flight and linchpins with unlimited bonding. I had no idea what that meant. Basically, just to explain it in an easy-to-understand way, what it means, it's a drone. It's a drone that flies up and is able to twist completely around and go in any direction. Go this way, this way, this way, this way. So it's just a drone system that can turn completely all the way around and go in different directions. Which, to my knowledge, we don't have this technology. I've never seen it before. It's very interesting. Maybe it's been done before and I'm just not aware of it, but it's pretty cool. And he's showing it to here to everybody right now. So Lynchpin is just the drone. Tangential flight just means that it's able to turn completely around. And unlimited bonding just means that it's able to go up and connect with another drone that looks the same. And they are able to connect again and connect again. And they are all able to connect with each other and make large formations. That's all it means. I think it's pretty interesting technology, and if it's real, who knows? Maybe he's lying. Maybe it already existed. I don't know, but if it's real, I think it should be looked at more, and we'll watch the clip here of him talking about it right now.
But I want to show you Lynchpin now. Here I've invented, here I'm an Oscar-nominated actor that is known all around the world, face recognition, vocal recognition, all around the world. I've invented a new form of flight, tangential flight, the ability to fly around your own center of mass, something they've never been able to do. And you don't hear anything about it. And it's unlimited bonding. If you can go to what Jonathan Davis sent over, he's one of the other programmers that work with us.
Explain what it does. Explain when you said flight, what do you mean?
Tangential flight.
What do you mean by that?
It means right now, fixed-wing aircraft, you can go in 4 degrees of direction. They go up, down. You know, some can go forwards and back, you know, backwards and right to left. But this is able to spin around its own center of mass. completely spin around its own center of mass, something they've never, people are able to do it by falling, but this is a sustained system that's able to go around. I sent that other video to you. But their ability, because this is the geometry of hydrogen, any bond that hydrogen can make, Lynchpin can make, and what they're basically doing is building the periodic table in front of you. If you play four of them coming together, it's four, like, 30-second videos. You know, I'll explain it out. But you'll see how these things align themselves. Well, this is the swarm, and they're all following this queen as a colony, and they'll do everything that she's doing. There's, go to the very first video. There's four in a row on it. Oh, that's how it came over to you. Well, let's see which one this is. This is four of them that's going to come together to pick up a barrel.
And what's powering them?
Right now, we're going to use hydrogen fuel cells. But I have another system, you know, that I was going to talk about in a second. But it's an unlimited source of power.
But, so hydrogen fuel cells,
or you can use lithium batteries.
And they're how are they moving? Like, what are those? Is that like a? Are those like propellers?
Yeah, those are props. But
okay,
but that right there.
Okay, so that's the part I wanted to play. Basically, he's just saying that the drones can spin completely around, which would explain UFOs, how they fly, stop, and then go back the other direction, which I don't think that we have that technology. So if this is real, I think this is a big deal. The other thing he says that they're going to use hydrogen fuel cells, which would be amazing if that's real. Who knows? Maybe he's lying. I don't know. I'm just saying these are some of the things that are very interesting about what he's talking about. Should be looked at more. If they have hydrogen fuel cells or some other unlimited source of energy to fuel these things, that's a pretty big deal. So tangential flight, or however you say it, spinning completely around, and it's a drone that can connect to the other drones and do all of these things. Pretty crazy. So, okay, we're going to keep going and get to the last one here. For this, we're going to go right to YouTube here, and we'll play the video. So during the interview, he kept talking about they recreated Saturn. He said they recreated Saturn without gravity. And I did not know what he meant. I thought it was crazy. What is he talking about? They're making planets. It doesn't make any sense. But in layman's terms, all that he's trying to say is all of the major universities use these particle physics simulators to kind of recreate models of the galaxy and planets. And they used, his team used, the same simulators, but they did not add gravity into the equation. And they were able to recreate Saturn without adding gravity in. So it's a pretty big deal, because if it's true, it could debate the theory of gravity. These planets were able to form without gravity, supposedly. So we'll watch the video here explaining it.
And then three, in groups of three around, that are spaced at 120 degrees apart. And the tilt of these ones on the bottom here is 109.5 degrees in relationship to the top ones that are creating this flat space on the top and the bottom. And they're spaced at 120 degrees radially. And then inside the model is three groups of particle systems with known masses up to 1,000 pounds, from 2.2 pounds to 1,000 pounds. And there's no gravity whatsoever in this model. There's no center attractor. So it's just vortexes and two magnetic fields, a north and a south polarity, and one harmonic resonance, which is emulating a vibration in the field in this region here where these vortexes are pointed. So it kind of just oscillates to give it a little bit of randomness in motion, so that the particles will kind of interact and bounce around like smoke or water, waves in water. And then when I hit play, it does it all by itself using physics simulations. So there's no animations at all in this model. And when I play it, this is what pops out.
Wow.
And then when I look down at the top, it makes the actual hexagon that NASA has observed on the top of Saturn.
Without gravity.
Without any gravity.
Okay, so that's what I wanted to play there. It's just showing the simulator recreating the model of Saturn, and they did not add gravity into the equation. So, I mean, again, maybe this is not true. Maybe they never did this. Maybe they're making it up. I don't know. Maybe it's a lie. But if it's real, it's a pretty big deal, is it not? Am I missing something? Let me know in the comments. Are these not, like, interesting things to look further at? Should they not be debated? Should we not talk about it? I mean, is it not real? I don't know. If what they are claiming is real, then it's, I think it deserves debate and discussion. So that's the last one I wanted to talk about. Those are the top five big takeaways that I had from the Terrence Howard interview. Let me know what you think. Am I missing something? Did I explain it correctly? Did I explain it in an easy-to-understand way? Because I'm just trying to break it down so that people like me and you can understand it in an easier way. It's really interesting stuff. Let me know what you think. Let me know in the comments below. And those are the top five takeaways that I got. What did you think? So whether you think he's right or wrong, or any of this is true, or maybe it's all a lie, who knows? Maybe he's crazy. I don't know. But these are a few of the things that I thought were really interesting that he brought to the public's attention, and he did it in a major mainstream way. So I don't know. I think people should look into it. I don't think we should just dismiss it. I think scientists should debate it, look at it, vet it, check it, and let us know. But I have a feeling none of that's probably going to happen. I don't think any mainstream scientists are going to take him serious, and we'll never actually know if he is real or not, because they're going to just say, oh, it's all fake, and just kind of dismiss it outright. So the math, I don't know about, you know, I'm not an expert. I don't know about a lot of this stuff. But one thing that I am confident that I think he is correct about is the fact that his overlining message was that everything is connected. Everything in the universe is one, and we are all connected to an ether of some kind. He's talking about the same things that Tesla was talking about and Walter Russell was talking about, and a lot of people have proposed these things before. He's bringing it back up in a new, modern, mainstream way, and I think it's really interesting. I do believe that everything is connected. I've always felt like that. So I think he's right about that. I know in my own personal situation, I had a pretty intense spiritual awakening, I guess you would call it, or whatever you want to call it, back in my early 20s, actually, that I've never really talked about very much. I did with some close friends and stuff, but I never got into a lot of the details. But this was in 2006. Into 2007 and 8. And so after those experiences, I know that everything is connected. I know that everything's one. And some of the stuff that I experienced, people would probably say crazy or not believe. So I don't want to get into all the details even, but I had flashes of, I guess you would call it, enlightenment. I don't like saying that word. I'm not saying I'm enlightened or anything, because anytime somebody says they're enlightened, they're immediately not anymore. So I'm not trying to say that, but I definitely had intense moments of enlightenment. It's fleeting. But basically, in a layman's way to understand enlightenment, all enlightenment is basically you have the awareness and the consciousness and the understanding that everything is connected, everything is one. We are connected to the plants, the trees, the air, the earth, the animals, the universe, the stars. And you have that as a feeling, not as a knowledge. and you really experience it. You experience the connection of everything. You are part of God, and you are part of the universe. And that's what enlightenment basically boils down to in a way. I mean, there's more to it, and you could never really describe it in a word or with words. Words are like signposts that kind of lead you in the right direction. But those are kind of some words to kind of point in the direction of what enlightenment or connection with the universe is. You never really know until you experience it. But I definitely had those moments, and I'll never forget that. And I still have it fleeting from time to time, but it's not nearly as intense as it was. I wish it would come back stronger. I need to meditate more and get better at getting back into that divine space. But that's how I know what he is talking about in his overall concept and theory is true, in my opinion. That's what I can talk about, is only my personal experiences and what I understand and what I believe to be true. And I think he's kind of trying to say the same thing, just in a different way. So that's my thoughts. Let me know, what do you think? Is any of this real? Is it all fake? Is it all a lie? Are we connected, or do we live in an isolated, dead universe like mainstream scientists want you to believe? I don't know. I think there's more to it. Let me know in the comments below. What do you think? Hit a like on the video. Hit the subscribe button. If you want to see more videos like this, let me know, because I don't do as much commentary, but I would like to get more consistent with it. So let me know if you think I should do more of the commentary stuff, or if I should focus more on the parody rap stuff. I do current event parody raps every week. So if you want to just come check out some of the songs and the funny takes that I have on some of the current event topics, you can do that here on the channel. Hit subscribe, and I will see you on the next one. Thank you for hanging out, and yeah, let me know what you think about Terrence Howard's theories below. Have a good day.